This is the GMBN Tech Essentials Series, our easy to follow guide to maintaining and setting up your bike. With a bit of basic understanding, just a few tools, you can all be looking after your bikes at home, which basically means in the long run, it is gonna save you money. For this particular video, we're looking at the quick release axles out there. There's quite a lot and it can be quite confusing. However, they're very easy to use and we wanna show you how to do it correctly and safely. So first up, what exactly is a bolt through axle? So these days they're often referred to as a quick release through axle. So this is more like a conventional quick release. Once upon a time, they were everywhere on mountain bikes, but as the technology has developed, they're quite rare these days, although you do still see them. Now the quick release through axle is essentially a very beefed up version of this. The reason for this is bikes now have suspension, quite often front and rear on them. And these actually form part of the structure of the frame to keep everything in check, everything nice and stiff. And ultimately, they're a lot stronger. Now, there are various different sizes and styles of quick release axles, also known as thru axles, on the market. Now, it does depend on the type of bike you have. So just for example, just assuming your bike has suspension forks on there, it's gonna have one of two main standards up front. It will either be boost or non-boost. Boost means it's 110mm spacing between them. Non-boost is 100mm. Nice and simple. Typically, front wheel axles tend to be 15mm, although you do still see some 20mm options, and these are also common in downhill bikes, just because they're a bit beefier. Outback is a little bit different. Axle size tends to be 12mm, and there are a few different widths of the back ends of bikes. Once upon a time, all mountain bikes were 135mm, and whilst you do still see this, it's far more common for them to be 142mm now. There's also boost, which is 148mm, and is a slightly newer size that's been referred to as super boost, and that is 157mm. Now, downhill bikes tend to have 150mm, and it's quite an exclusive size for them, but it's no stranger to see the odd downhill bike having a 148 boost on there, and sometimes 157, so they don't kind of fall under the same camp as conventional mountain bikes. So, in particular with the rear ones, it can be quite confusing. So why are there all these different sizes? Originally, they were 135mm because that was the width of standard rear hubs. Now, as cassettes got bigger and you had more gears on a bike, the hub needed to start getting wider to accommodate all of that and still maintain a nice strong wheel. If you think about the rear hub of the wheel, it has to have the cassette on there and it has to have the nice bracing angle for those spokes in order to build a tensioned and strong wheel. Now, with respect to hub sizing and how it's changed over the years, those traditional 135s, like I say, they were superseded by the 142 size, and are still a very common size on mountain bikes. But 148 is becoming increasingly popular, and you'll see this on most new mountain bikes. In particular, ones running a 1x transmission on there. Now, the reason for that is to get, ultimately, a better chain line, and also to allow enough tire clearance for the design of the bike. Now, when I'm talking about chain line, it's essentially being able to line up the center line of the front chainring with the center of the rear cassette. So that means the chain has to do the least amount of work to get across all of the gears. Obviously, to do that, things need to be spaced out slightly at the back end, so you have that 148mm size. So now, as you can see here on this particular bike, so this has a boost 148mm rear end. It's got a 1x11 transmission on there. And as you can see, there's loads of tire clearance. This is a nice big 2.3 tire on the back. I can stick my hand down the sides of here, so you've got all the clearance you need for mud, nice amount of clearance for the chainring there against the frame, and of course, a really good chain line. So of course, I've just explained the 148 to you, so why is there the need for more axle standards? Well, quite simply, for more stiffness and more strength on the back end of a bike. Now, what I'm talking about here is our enduro racing focused bikes or gravity style bikes. Now, the wider you can get the back end of the bike, the further the spoke bracing angle can be and the stiffer and stronger the back end of the bike can actually be. But of course, for normal mountain bikes, virtually everything you'll see will be 148. And don't worry, that is here to stay. Now, there's a lot of different style quick release thru axles available on the market, but I'm holding here three of the most common ones that you'll see on most bikes. So first up, there's the RockShox Maxle. Now you see this in front and rear orientations to fit on your forks or on the frame. There's the Fox QR15 system, which you see mostly on forks, but you do see this on frames as well. Very simple system. and then there's the DT system as well, which you see on both forks and frames. And you also see a lot of manufacturers adopting this exact system under different names. Now there are many other options out there and they all tend to work on very similar principles. There's the Synthase system, of course there's the system used by Cane Creek on their own ones, I think that's called the D-Lock system, but they all fundamentally work on the same principles as these. Both the RockShox Maxwell and the Fox QR15, also known as the Shimano QR15 because they were developed in conjunction, they both work on a similar principle of a cam operated lever. They're slightly different in the way that you can adjust them, which I'll show you later. And then there's the DT system, which simply screws into the frame or into the fork, and then you can adjust the position of the actual lever afterwards to orientate it in a suitable position. Now, whilst they're all fairly self-explanatory and they are very easy to use, it's also equally easy to not use them correctly. And what I mean by that is a few different things that are quite common to happen, and you might have had one of these happen with you. So you might find you're over-tightening them, which means using all your body weight on those levers to tighten them into the frame or the fork, end up with a red mark on your hand from the lever. You never really want to be over-tightening these, you simply don't need to do it, and all you're going to end up doing is damaging it at the end of the day. The next option is under-tightening them, so you're not sufficiently tightening them into the fork or frame. Now you don't need to be a genius to work out this could be very dangerous. If they're not tight, they can work their way loose, and the absolute worst case could happen, the axle could slide out, which would mean you'd lose the wheel off the bike. So it's really important from a safety point of view to make sure they're done up properly onto the bike as they're supposed to be done. Now the final one is actually making sure that lever is orientated in the right position in the first place. Now as I'm going to explain to you with these different axles how they go into the bike, if you tighten this one in, for example, and it's tight here, you'll find that you actually want the lever to be in line with the fork, really. You don't want it to be sticking out the front. So when it's actually sufficiently tight, you can adjust the end of the actual lever itself to sit in the correct position. What you don't want to be doing is having to over-tighten it to get it into that position, or under-tighten it, and it doesn't go far enough, so it's not actually screwed in enough, even though the lever is in the ideal position. I can't emphasize this enough. It's a safety-orientated product. They're dead simple to use, so this is how you use the main three. So the QR15 system, often known as the Fox QR15 or the Shimano QR15, very simple. There's a lever with a cam, the axle, and it's got a threaded bit on the end. And then of course there is the threaded captive nut that's part of the fork there that this screws into. Now this does have the facility to allow you to change the orientation of where the lever locks just to make sure it's in the correct place. Nice, simple system to use. Simply slide the axle into place, and then when you find it hits those threads at the back, tighten it up. Now you don't want to tighten it all the way, so an easy way to do this is to go all the way until it's tight and then come back a full half turn there, and then you need to be tightening the actual lever there so it sits in front of the fork, and what you're looking for is a gap of between 1 and 20 millimeters daylight here between the actual lever itself and the front of the fork. What you don't want is for it to be tightened against the fork, for example, in which case the cam will never allow you to tighten it fully and it could just come undone. You don't want that to happen for obvious reasons. And if, for example, yours are tightening up in the wrong orientation, you can actually change this on the other side by actually moving that captive nut. Now that's very easy to do. All you need to do is loosen the 2.5 millimeter Allen key bolt just here, and that gives you access to that captive nut. To actually move it around, you need to loosen off the actual quick release lever itself, and then you can put the nut in the correct orientation so the lever closes against the fork leg like we just showed you. So there you go, nice and simple. So that nut has actually got indents all the way around it and it's got numbers on there. So when you get it to your sweet spot, you can remember that in case you accidentally move it in future. So just a quick recap on QR15. What you're looking for is the lever to be sufficiently tight that there's a resistance when you undo it and a resistance when you tighten it, but nothing too much. You don't want to have a mark in your hand when you're pushing it closed. And likewise, you don't want it to be loose so it could come open. The lever itself needs to sit between 1 and 20 millimeters away from the front of the fork leg when it's in the correct orientation. And if it's not tightening at this point, you can actually change the orientation by moving the nut around that's on the other side. Nice and simple. This axle is the Maxwell. So this is the RockShox system. You'll see this on loads of bikes. It's the same system on the front and on the rear. Exactly the same system applies. You slide the axle straight through until it locates with the threads, which are on the opposite side. You simply tighten up that axle to get to the end, come back half a turn, and then tighten it. Nice and simple. As with the QR15 system, there should be a good resistance, but it shouldn't be like crazy tight, and neither should it be loose. Common sense dictates how tight it should be. As for the lever position, it's not quite as crucial as it is with a QR15. The only position you should really not have it in is against the fork leg, for the same reason. It's not going to tighten properly because of the cam, and of course, if you do crash or something, it could well cause some damage to the fork and the quick release, or both. What I would say is, for common sense reasons, you don't want to have your maxle, when it's tightened, facing forwards. If you hit some shrubbery, some overgrown bushes and stuff on your travels, it could flip it open, which of course you might not notice, and it might rattle its way out as you're riding. Of course, that's not going to end well. So common sense dictates where you tighten it up. Like the QR15, you can change the orientation of the lever when it's actually tight, but unlike the QR15, where you simply loosen it and you would adjust it, the threaded nut that sits into the fork, on this system, the adjustment is on the actual axle itself. So you have to remove the axle. When you've got the axle in hand, you can see there's some markings here, with a little line here to correlate to them. And to actually change the position of the lever in relation to the axle, you push it in and locate that. So as you can see here, I'm just gonna change position by moving that in. And that changes the orientation of the axle, and you tighten it up. Okay, so now we're gonna take a look at the DT style system. So this is a front one, which is a 15 millimeters, and this is a rear one, which is a 12. So I'm gonna show you how to install that. They're both exactly the same in the way that they operate. Very simple system. So you simply line up the wheel into the frame, as you would with any bike. Then you simply slide the axle through until it grips into the threads on the drive side and tighten the lever. It's as simple as that. You get to a point where it feels nice and tight, then you'll find that the lever is not in a good orientation. Now, on this system, you can literally pull the lever up and you can adjust it to get it out of harm's way in a nice position. Now, some people do like to put them up against the frame. Some people like to put them in different positions. What you don't want to do is have it in a position like this where you could accidentally hit this with your ankle and undo it. Of course, the whole point of these is that they stay tight on the bike. And you also just get conventional bolt through axles that use a single Allen key to tighten them in. You get RockShox Maxle Stealth is one of the options, which looks like this one here, but all fairly similar. What you will find on all of them though, is a torque setting on there. Now that's the recommended tightness that you should tighten these to. Now I'm fully aware that not everyone has access to a torque wrench, so you need to use a bit of common sense here to see how tight you need it to be. I would say, like, this is loose at the moment and that's where it catches. Good bit of tightness and that will be sufficient. But it is something you should definitely monitor, because they don't have the cam system that you get with the levers to make sure that you can visibly see that they're tight. These ones could come loose, so it is worth checking them from time to time. Now, if you do have access to a torque wrench, this particular one says between 9 and 13 newton meters, so I would set the newton meter setting on the actual torque wrench there. So this one, I've set it at 11, as you can see on the scale there. And now you don't really want to be tightening up everything with the torque wrench. It's basically just to check it's to the correct torque. So you would still tighten it by hand until you think it's about right. Remove your Allen key, put the correct size bit in this case is a 6 millimeter, in there, and then tighten it. There you go. And that's the point where it's telling me I've tightened it sufficiently. Now, one important thing just to say about torque settings are they are recommended. It's not essential. You can tighten it without having to have a torque wrench. It's just an advisory. And because it's a safety item, I have to recommend that you do use one of these, but it's not an absolute necessity. As long as you monitor it and you make sure it's sufficiently tight, you will be safe. So there we go. We've taken a look at the most common ones out there, the DT, the QR15, and the two offerings from RockShox. Now, there are many other ones on the market, but they all fundamentally rely on the same principles. So you don't want to be over-tightening them. You don't want to under-tighten them for any risk of them coming loose. You don't want the lever to be fouling on the frame or the fork, because it could damage those in the event of a collision or accident. And of course, it will never be tightened sufficiently in the first place. The final thing to check is the orientation of the lever, so it can't accidentally be opened by shrubbery or anything else when you're riding, or in the rear axle case, that you can't accidentally loosen this with your foot. Nice and simple. Now there's going to be a whole bunch more essentials videos following this very one, so I hope you've enjoyed it. And if there are any essentials videos you want to see in the series, let us know in those comments below. In the meantime, if you want to understand a bit about bike setup in regards to how it affects your riding, the climbing, your saddle discomfort, hand pain, any of that sort of stuff, check that video out. It's a good one. It will explain a lot of the basic bike setup for you. As always, click on the round globe to subscribe to GMBN Tech. And if there's anyone out there that you know that needs some help with their bikes, make sure you share it around a bit. And of course, if you found this video helpful, give us a thumbs up.